Hello and welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Broya and here are your headlines for tonight. We talk to the Green Party councillor Elaine Hills for a local update. We check out Matey Measure. We speak to the Stanmer Preservation Society. We check out art in Stanmer Park. We talk to Brighton Pigeon Rescue. We talk about Glyndebourne. Plus, we look at Seasalt Housing Cooperative. Firstly, we now get an update from the Green Party councillor Elaine Hills to get a local update. This is what she had to say to Mark Walker in the studio.
With Green Party councillor Elaine Hills, Hanover and Elm Grove, also on the Children and Young People's Committee, and we're talking about the Multicultural Schools Fund, aren't we? School Books Fund.
The Multicultural School Book Fund, yes.
School Book Fund, and you're here to tell us all about it. Sounds a great idea. How's it actually work in practice?
Well, it wasn't me who started it. It was a local resident called Lisa Hayworth, and she realised that a lot of school libraries don't depict enough people from a range of backgrounds. You know, I think in society, 30% of people are from Black, Asian or minority ethnic backgrounds. But in books, there was a survey done a few years ago, and it was only 1% of main characters, and I think 4% overall of characters. You know, obviously there's been Black Lives Matters protests, and it's made us really, really aware that we need to just do better and become anti-racist, not just say we're not racist. We have to do things to sort of step up, make sure that children from, you know, all backgrounds feel represented in the things they read. So Lisa set up the fund. Her aim is, we have 64 schools in Brighton and Hove, and she wants to raise £64,000. So there can be £1,000 worth of books, more or less, in every school. Depends what they've got already as well.
Yeah.
So that's the aim. And the first school, she's already raised £1,000 to put books into Hartford Infant School. So that's really nice. We as a council just put £1,000 into the pot. So that should be another school's worth of books as well.
Yeah. And it's really important, isn't it? Because people, when youngsters, when they're in a school, they want to see themselves represented in the school materials, right? I mean, it makes sense, doesn't it? And that's, it takes time to make change, doesn't it?
It does take time.
Particularly libraries, you know, there's not always a budget to kind of get your library restocked with other books. People want to see a range of voices. That's
they
what
do.
We're hearing, isn't it?
And schools, obviously, at the minute are really, really hard up because of government cuts. And the likelihood of them just... I know one or two schools have managed to put a good range of books from different people of colour, illustrators, you know, novelists, all that kind of thing into their libraries. But not many have. And the other thing is, a lot of schools think, oh, if we've got Black children in the school, we've got children from Asian families, we need more of those books. But actually, no, all schools need these books. We need to sensitise all children to the diversity of the culture that we live in. So it's really, really important that all schools have a range of books.
Councillor Elaine Hills, thanks for coming in today. All the best with schemes in Hanover. Thanks for coming.
Cheers. Thank you very much,
thanks.
Mark.
We now speak to inventor Steve Capon about his latest invention, the Matey Measure. This is what he had to say.
So Matey Measure, and I'm here with Steve Capon, who is an inventor. Tell us all about Matey Measure, because it's a much needed invention, really, isn't it? A lot of people have trouble with tape measures, including myself, nearly knocking myself out with the old end of the tape measure, or, you know, almost blinding myself.
Well, over the years, I've seen my granddad, who's a builder, and my dad as a builder, and many other builders and labourers use a tape measure. And when they bend the tape measure on the curve of the tape measure up to a recess and an end measurement, they have to guess that last bit because the curve of the tape measure doesn't go right in the corner.
Yeah.
And that's how Matey Measure come about. Bypassing the bend, sliding it across, hitting the moment of measurement, clamping it, and when you lift the tape measure down, you've got the accurate measurement.
Yeah, to the millimetre.
To the millimetre, spot on.
That's what we need, yeah. And so it's amazing it wasn't invented before, isn't it, this kind of gadget, because it is a common problem, isn't it?
It is. Obviously, you've got laser measures.
Yeah.
Which are great, but they do cost a lot of money.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the minimum you can pay, I think you can buy them for about £30 now. They need batteries, And it's a piece of kit that could easily get broken on a site and be stolen. And, you know, with Matey Measure, it's stainless steel. It's completely free from batteries, so it's eco. It's got a tape measure on it as well. It's got a 65 mil rule on it that you can use for in the building game as well. And it clips onto your toolkit, onto your belt. It's got a hole for a keyring as well. And it's completely 100% stainless steel. So when you buy one of these, it's for life.
Yeah.
You don't ever have to buy batteries for it. You've got it. It's a friend for life.
Exactly, yeah. So it's not only builders, though, is it? It's people at home doing DIY might need
this. DIYs, that's a big market. I mean, lots of people have to cut a shelf and it's not always square within a recess. Perfect for them. Anywhere that you measure in a recess, really. And we've all done it. We've all had to use a tape measure at some point in our life, and most of us have got a tape measure in our drawer. And we've, at some point, come across that problem. Oh, I can't get that accurate.
Okay, once again, what's the website before we finish up?
www.mateymeasure.com.
And that's Matey Measure. So, Steve, all the best with that, and we'll catch up soon. Cheers.
Thanks. Thank you. Bye.
Mark Walker then spoke to Sue Craig from the Stanmer Preservation Society to talk about its work and changes in Stanmer Park.
So I'm here with Sue Craig, who is from Stanmer Preservation Society. We're going to be talking about the development on top of around Coldean, top of Coldean Hill. Tell us about the development first and then about your objections, because I know it's both the Preservation Society but also Coldean Residents Association that are against the current proposals.
Yes, we are completely against the proposals in Stanmer because it is a registered and a Grade 2 listed and registered garden, and we feel that any development on it is inappropriate within the setting of the South Downs National Park.
Yeah, OK. Exactly, it's a site of special scientific interest. I know there's badger sets there and it's a chalk grassland. South Downs National Park have also registered their objections. I know you've got another query about the actual the impact, environmental impact assessment as well.
Yes, well, when I looked in... The problem with Brighton Council's planning committee is that they're given hundreds and hundreds of pages a couple of days before the planning committee. So there's a lack of scrutiny on behalf of the councillors, which is understandable. They're very, very busy, and some of these reports run to 300 pages. And I do appreciate that. So they tend to rely on expert reports. And if the expert reports are flawed, then things get passed that have not been fully scrutinised. And that is certainly the case here, where the environmental impact assessment screening opinion was only half uploaded to the planning portal. So significant pages were not uploaded, I'm sure, by mistake, but to miss out half a report is questionable. So I wrote to every member of the planning committee to ask if they had seen this, and I haven't had a reply from any of them about whether they knew that they were signing a composite application for change of use and planning, and whether they knew whether they had seen the whole of the environmental screening opinion.
So thanks for coming in, Sue, today.
Thank you.
All the best. Thanks.
Thanks very much.
Lastly, keeping to the Stanmer Park theme, Olivia Marshall visits an art exhibition there, and here is her report.
Deep in Stanmer Park, Artway Festival have made a creative paradise. From images drawn into wood with fire to large stone sculptures, the free exhibition gives the opportunity for the public to enjoy the range of artistic talent that we have on our doorstep. For the artists involved, having the opportunity to be able to showcase their art to the public after lockdown has been very welcomed.
I find it great to see people, other people going into that with their own imagination, with their own stuff, seeing things I didn't see. You know, it's beautiful.
Yolly's exhibition is called Reading Into the Wood. It is a display of wood stories that are drawn with fire on pieces of wood burr. By following the lines and patterns of the wood grain, she can reveal fascinating and magical imagery of both human and nature stories from within the wood itself.
It's like tracing images that are not from my inner world, and they tell stories. It's just, it's a magical process, you know, of seeing stuff in the woods and following it. Sometimes you like, you know, you just follow what you see.
For Colombian sculptor Rafael Berrio, lockdown was an opportunity for artistic experimentation. The time led to the creation of his exhibition, Touchwood and Stars.
This new work is part of the inspiration from the lockdown, when people, we were really, you know, we never had that experience. And the media, and we got scared, and the regulation and the law. But me on the respecting the guideline. I used to just go to the woods and hiding and making new work. I know that for some people it's been quite difficult, but I was lucky because, you know, I had a creative mind that sometimes people can spread themselves even during the down writing or doing some drawing and painting. So that's been considering myself unlucky. And sharing the space, it's been great because you get the feedback and you can see people smiling, visiting outdoors, and we need to smile and have that spirit in this difficult time, you know, the pandemic.
That's it for the first half. Join us in the second half for a chat with Brighton Pigeon Rescue, a talk about Glyndebourne, plus we check out Seasalt Housing Cooperative. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Broyer. Now for that update from Brighton Pigeon Rescue.
I'm here with Theo Williams from Brighton, Pigeon Rescue Brighton.
That's right.
And we're here to talk about obviously pigeons, but also birds in general. But first of all, I know that there's been some cases, particularly a local superstore, where people are using netting to, you know, to kind of make sure that pigeons don't go onto certain areas of buildings, etc. Tell us about the problem that you've been dealing with.
Well, that's right, Mark. In Church Road, Hove, Tesco's, the new superstore, it's very high up at the top of the building. There's a circular dome area, and the birds were nesting in there. And recently they put netting up about a month ago, but the birds were still getting in through a hole in the roof where you could see the roof had fallen in and broken a little bit, and they couldn't get out again. So they were going into net and getting trapped and starving to death and dying from dehydration and hunger. And then that's been going on for about the past month. It was brought to my attention last week. There was a demo done last weekend with various activists, but I'm not an activist. I'm a charity worker, so that's somewhat different. And I went down there, but I didn't get actively involved in it. And I met the police down there, and the day before I'd phoned up the wildlife crime prevention officer, Danny Heath, who covers this town, and got him to meet me on site at Tesco's, and he assessed the situation, agreed that offences had been committed under the Wildlife Act Section 4, causing unnecessary suffering, and statements were taken, long-range photos were taken, and it's going through the motions and of prosecution towards Tesco.
So. Yeah, so we do have a wildlife crime officer then, is that for the Sussex Police?
Yeah, Sussex Police, yeah, he's a PCSO, but he works from, he works from Crowhurst Road Police Station.
Yeah.
He's a fully-fledged officer, and every town's got a wildlife crime prevention officer, so it's not just rural places like Arms in Norfolk or something, every town's got one.
Okay, we'll leave it there for now then. Thanks for coming in today, Theo, and we'll catch up again soon. All the best with the Pigeon Rescue Brighton.
All right, thank you, Mark.
Cheers, thanks.
Andrew Kay then spoke to Ben Glesser, Glyndebourne's conductor, in the studio. Here is the report.
My guest in the studio today is Ben Glassberg. Ben is actually the Glyndebourne Tour conductor.
That's right.
That's the full title.
Yeah? Principal conductor.
Principal conductor.
But you can call me whatever you want, I don't mind.
I've downgraded your job. Now, the tour can't take place in the way that it usually does. I mean, the tour is usually a couple of productions from the festival, which of course couldn't really take place this year because of COVID, and some revivals. Often when I go and see the tour productions, it says, you know, the tour production, so don't expect the full thing. But quite honestly, they seem to be as grand as the festival productions, perhaps sometimes just with different principles. But on the whole, they are the same. But given the state of the nation at the moment, you've had to do something very different this year. So what is actually taking place?
Well, I mean, it's really quite amazing what Glyndebourne have put together. First, obviously, over the summer in the open air, when performances were just starting to be allowed again. But actually, we are now presenting a full autumn season at Glyndebourne because, sadly, we can't take any shows to the touring venues because they are all in a really sticky situation at the moment. So we're performing a fully staged production of In the Market for Love, which is a new version by Stephen Place of Jacques Offenbach's Les Mesdames de la Halle, the Women of the Market. marketplace, which is a really funny, silly farce, but with some really beautiful, glorious tunes.
So you that can was... count on Offenbach for pretty tunes.
Oh, absolutely. And it's a nightmare when you're trying to get to sleep of an evening after rehearsals. You cannot get the tunes out of your head. Which is quite rare when working in opera, to be honest. You know, it's not like we're known for our catchy tunes like musicals. So it's really wonderful to be working on something where really you've got these earworms going on. So that's fabulous. And it's great to be able to have our Glyndebourne Tour Orchestra back in the pit. We have 19 players, which is the maximum we can fit socially distanced in a pit. And we've got, it's a new reduction from the original orchestral version that we're doing for this.
So a chamber version.
Exactly. And then we're also doing concert performances or even semi-stage performances of the Magic Flute, cut down from the usual 2 and a bit hours to 90 minutes. So it's basically just the best bits.
Which I have to say, with Magic Flute, there is so much dialogue. Which, yes. In German, you can get a little bogged down in it, can't you?
Absolutely.
I mean, to put so many beautiful tunes into so much, because it wasn't an opera, it was a musical play.
Finally, Mark Walker spoke to Seasalt Housing Cooperative. Simin Wadiwala and Ophelia Mansi had a chat with Mark in the studio.
So I'm here with Ophelia Mansi and we've got Simin Wadiwala, and we're going to be talking about housing issues, particularly Seasalt, which you guys are going to explain what Seasalt is. Should we start with Simin? Just tell us a bit about what Seasalt is and about why you've chosen to get into this project. And we're also going to talk about the housing crisis in the city as well. Mm-hmm. Maybe start off with Seasalt.
Yeah, of course. So Seasalt is a student housing cooperative. That means that it is a accommodation for students that is student run, that is managed entirely by students. The reason I got involved with this was because I personally had a lot of bad experiences with housing. A lot of my friends too at university, kind of time and time again, not only were the expenses, the prices extortionate, but the maintenance wasn't kept up. You know, you'd report issues to the landlord, they'd say, oh, just deal with it, or not put nearly enough time and energy into actually fixing the issue.
You didn't feel like a priority at all, and you're constantly living in subpar conditions, which you're just meant to put up with.
Yeah. So, and a lot of people do just put up with it, but I know you went a step further. What is Seasalt? What does it actually stand for?
Seasalt stands for Southeast Students Autonomously Living Together. We operate as a cooperative, and what that means is that every single person who lives in the house is a member and has an equal vote to, say, decide on how maintenance should happen in the house, or how whether our rent should change, and if members don't agree on it, then it won't happen.
It's an entirely democratic process. That's what we're aiming for, everyone to be equal in the decision making. And our ethos and the general kind of philosophy is, if you put the care into the house, it will care back for you.
Yeah, exactly. So how's it work in practice? People still pay rent, they kind of have they would stay in this kind of project for like 3 or 4 years during the term of their student living. I mean, it's basically a bit like communal living, isn't it, with people that are living in it having a much greater say over how it's run on a day-to-day basis.
Definitely. Yeah. Our priority is community first, as well as affordability. So the rent will be a lot lower rate than you're dealing with, for example, in East Slope Halls at Sussex, which is £160 a week. And our emphasis is, we would love to have kind of communal cooking, share the responsibilities of that. We're even looking for an allotment garden space, which really helps with mental health as well and gets everyone involved together in some kind of activity that could bond the house together, as well as having a really nice big open space for everyone to enjoy.
Yeah, so what are the next steps? Because I know that you're looking for a property. So I know you work with the Community Land Trust. We've spoken about them a few times on latest TV news. So just what's the order of things? What are the next steps?
Absolutely. So we're partnering with Brighton and Hope Community Land Trust, who are going to buy a house and then lease it out to us on a long term. Now, what that requires is raising investment. So they currently have a share offer open, aiming to raise £260,000, of which we've got about £120,000 of the way there. Once we reach this target, we can go into looking at properties. So we have looked at multiple properties in the past, but we need the money to put down a deposit, as well as to pay for any upfront costs and renovations. And once that happens, we go through the process of making surveys, going to our solicitors, formalising the contract. And once that happens, we can Seasalt can move into the house, and we've got our own application for a whole membership process, and we can have the first cohort of students living in there.
Yeah. It's been a really collaborative process with the Brighton and Hove Community Land Trust, and I currently hold a director position there. Recently, I'm on a board with six other people, so that really enables us to kind of connect together and keep our interests together, as well as regular property updates and any other exciting things that are going to be happening soon.
So the main thing is that a lot of people complain in Brighton about them not feeling that they don't have control of, you know, their life, really, because obviously your home is a big part of your life. So what you bring to the table is more stability, right? This is one of the key factors, isn't it?
Students are in such a precarious position, and we're expected to move yearly. Sometimes you don't have a property over the summer, and it's just really transient, and it can kind of hinder your experience, because if you would like to develop strong bonds with your house and ground yourself in a space, you physically can't if you have to move every year. So our aim is to have a kind of long-term alternatives to student housing. We're imagining a future that's not riddled with expenses and problems. We're imagining something that's a lot more concrete and communal.
And where you can integrate yourself in the community.
Yeah.
And get to know your neighbours.
You're not just a student, you're also a Brighton resident as well.
Okay, so Ophelia Sidman-Fex coming today. All the best with the project, and I hope it goes well for you.
Thanks so much.
Cheers.
That's it for today. Join us tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Good night.